Your name. I think Aaron pretty much got everybody coming in, but we have some certificates for you that we will print out here before you leave. We are recording this session, and for the first time ever, this is being live streamed on our YouTube channel. So for those that couldn't come today, they hopefully are live right now, looking at me through a couple cameras. So but we do make this video available immediately after the session on YouTube if you want to check that out and refresh some things. Our next training session, if you want to put it on your calendar now, is June 20th, and it will be the corollary to this, which is clean fluids for oils, for lubricants, which will be an interesting topic. So let's jump into the introduction of our presenter, as always, our friend Russ Seideman. Many of you that have been here before know that Russ has his degree in chemical engineering, and he started with UNICAL 76 in 1982, and he graduated from the technical products program. Now he is STLE certified both as a lubricant specialist and as an oil monitoring analyst. So basically it would do us all well to listen to what he says. That's all I'm trying to say. He does know what he's talking about for sure. In fact, about 11 years ago, we brought Russ on as our in-house engineer. We found that having that capability and that expertise in-house has made a big difference for us, for our customers, prospects. It's great to have Russ on call at all times. Now, what you may not know, and he didn't know this until just now that I was going to put this up here, Russ just recently returned from Spain, where he competed in a triathlon, an Ironman level triathlon for the United States. So Russ represented us right there, as you can see him up in the corner. He competed with these other U.S. athletes and hundreds of others in a triathlon. Did an excellent job in his age group. He always ranks. He is an absolute athlete, if anybody is. So with that, oh, and by the way, and when he's not swimming, biking, or running, he likes to get about four stories high on the nearest, I think that was some kind of a cooler system tower, up there. Yeah. So anyway, we're glad to have Russ. Please help me in welcoming Russ Seideman.
Thanks, Steve. All right, well, welcome back to, again, another one of these training sessions. I know I got a lot of familiar faces out here, and I think some new folks as well. As Tim mentioned, we had done this topic just over a year ago. I went back and kind of redid the whole thing. You will see, if you saw that topic before, you will see a few slides and a few things that just kind of make sense to repeat them. In this presentation, of course, we're emphasizing on fuels, and I hope to be able to send everybody away with some really helpful, useful stuff to know about cleanliness and diesel fuel. That's kind of the big picture. So once again, we broke this into three bite-sized chunks. We're going to do three sections. Within the first section, we're going to talk about where the need comes from for very clean diesel fuel. Because diesel fuel has always needed to be clean. There's always been diesel filters, or at least one or more on a truck or a diesel engine. But that need has greatly increased. We'll also talk a little bit about the fuel background, because fuel today is not the same as fuel was 20 or 30 years ago. Maybe not even the same as it was 10 years ago. In our second section, we're going to talk a little bit about the common contaminants that we're dealing with and how we categorize those, as well as what do we mean by cleanliness and clean fuel, and how are we going to define clean? And then we'll talk about how do we test for it? What kind of tests do we run? What kind of tests could you have run on your fuel? And in our third section, we're going to go ahead and say, okay, if we've got a dirty tank, we've got dirty fuel, what do we do about it? So there's cleaning up. How do we clean up our fuel? How do we clean up our tanks? What can be done there? And then what can we do to prevent these kind of things going forward? So those are our topics for the day. And as is our usual situation, in between each of these, or following each of these three sections, we have a period for some questions, if you've got questions that have been festering while you're talking along here. Okay, so we will start off talking about the importance of fuel cleanliness. Now, we've got a few different factors that show up as far as fuel cleanliness and what's driving this. Probably the dominant one, the key here, is this idea, the utilization in the vast majority of diesel trucks now have the high pressure common rail injection systems. High pressure, as opposed to just generating a little bit of high pressure at the injector, now the pressure is generated throughout this system. And this is making a difference in how the hardware is designed. And we're talking high pressures. The pressures, you guys who work on diesels know this, we're talking in the 35,000 PSI range. These are extremely, extremely high pressures. And we're also talking about very, very tiny tolerances throughout the system. And one of the next important piece of hardware we look at, and where the tolerance is probably the most critical, are the injectors. Okay? Injector tolerances between the pintle, the very end of the injector, somewhere in the anywhere from 1 to 4 microns. Extremely, extremely tiny openings. So just the smallest particle interfering with flow through an injector will do what to your spray pattern, right? It alters the spray pattern. If you get a bad spray pattern, what happens to the quality of your combustion? And then what happens to your power level, your economy, and your emissions? So that happens whether you're blocking it with a particle or whether you get some sort of a fuel-based varnish buildup that alters the flow, again, in this 1 to 3 or 4 micron opening. Very critical. Okay? Fuel pumps. Fuel pumps, another critical point of the whole system. Any pump that's got to be working to generate 35,000 PSI, okay, at some stage, has to be machined to, again, these very, very tiny tolerances. And you do that because you can't have, you can't have any backflow going back on any moving parts. So this is another thing driving the cleanliness requirements behind our diesel fuel. Because what you're going to end up with are performance problems with symptoms like hard starting. Again, that's a classic spray pattern issue. Decreased power, poor mileage, and increased smoke going on. All right. So this is my very quick overview why this cleanliness is important in modern engines. Engine in the diesel fleet that was around in 1960, nowhere near as critical as far as this kind of cleanliness went. Another thing that's different, and another reason that clean fuels are important, has to do with what we're putting in them. Diesel fuels are different today than they used to be. Okay? Now we've got two relatively new features of diesel fuel to talk about that make them different today than they were before. Historically, stability is what was important. It was called stability. This still is important, by the way. I'm not going to downplay it. And stability had to do with some chemical reactions that would occur inside the diesel fuel as it aged, as it got older, as it reacted with oxygen. Sometimes it reacted with other parts of the diesel fuel. You can see that going on. So this idea of linear versus cyclic fuel stocks. In a 1 hour lunchtime, I'm not going to take you through all the tinker toy chemistry that I can on these hydrocarbons, but you can see in these tinker toys, there's lots of these circle things going on. This is a very cyclic example of a stock. The linear stocks look more like trees with just branches going off each other. Okay, well, those guys both behave differently towards oxygen and towards oxidation. And so the one that's branched and tree-like is more stable than this stuff. This stuff sitting around in a tank eventually reacts with oxygen, and it gloms together with a few other molecules, and they glom together with a few others. And the way these things go is pretty soon you've got a very tiny, tiny particle, and that tiny particle gathers together with other tiny particles, and they keep gathering until they actually make a particle that's heavy enough to fall through the fuel in the bottom of the tank and stay on the bottom. So after a long time, you end up with a particle sediment that can happen. So that happens from both what can happen with these cyclic stocks as well as with cracked fuel stocks. Again, another couple hours I could give you on refinery technology, but the stuff that comes out of the refinery as diesel fuel isn't all perfectly identical by any stretch of the imagination. So some of it's been beat up a lot, some of it hasn't been. The beat up stuff is the stuff that's more susceptible to reacting with the oxygen and then coming together and forming these particles over time. And when I'm saying over time, I'm not talking a week here, I'm talking months, but coming together over time, causing particles and dropping to the bottom. All right? There we are. Reactions result in causing particles. They grow in size and they drop out, forming sediment. Okay, so that's the historical case. That still is somewhat true. But related to that is something that is different today than used to be true, and that is diesel fuel sulfur. Okay? I think everybody knows probably that there's sulfur in diesel fuel, and if you've got some gray hairs, you know how much sulfur used to be in diesel fuel. And that's what this chart shows. That's what I wanted to talk about. Up until about 1997, typical diesel fuel had anywhere from 3,000 to 5,000 parts per million of sulfur. Okay? That's a lot of sulfur. I mean, you could smell it in this stuff. I put 3,000 on this chart, but it would be way off the chart if I put the 5,000 number up there. Okay, but 3,000 was a typical, probably a typical level. You did certain things. You had so much sulfur in this fuel, you actually had to formulate your engine oil very carefully to neutralize the sulfuric acid that would happen inside an engine. Because your engine, because it had so much sulfur, was generating sulfuric acid, and your sulfuric acid would chew away at all that soft metal on your bearings if you didn't have a engine oil that could neutralize all that acid. That was a pretty big deal back in the day. Well, come up to 2003, and the EPA reduced the sulfur level. Up to 97 is when the EPA reduced the sulfur level requirement to 500 parts per million. You know, something on the order of a tenfold decrease. 500 parts per million of sulfur in diesel fuel. Okay? And definitely doing the engine some favors by getting the sulfur out of there. Now, as some unintended consequences, the things that go on in removing sulfur also began to remove some other compounds. We'll talk about those in a second. And then in 2003, the next stage of the EPA's plan to reduce sulfur took it down to 15 parts per million. Okay, so we went from the 3,000 to 5,000 range down to 15. And if you look on this chart, you can see 15 barely shows up as a one pixel line on the bottom. I mean, this is how dramatically reduced sulfur. Sulfur is essentially removed from diesel fuel. And in fact, the diesel fuel has a sulfur spec, has this 15 parts per million requirement. There isn't a spec on gasoline, but gasoline naturally in itself actually has a higher sulfur level than this. So it's a, or can have, depending on its source. So you've really got in almost all your diesel fuel less sulfur than you would have in gasoline. And now we ran into further unintended consequences, because how many people here remember when you went to this and there started to be injector problems? Okay? Turns out the process that stripped the sulfur out of this also stripped out some other components that provided lubricity to moving parts either inside the fuel pumps and inside the injectors. And so these, without the lubricity there, we were getting premature wear on that. So they came back, the manufacturers of diesel fuel were now required and to put in a lubricity additive of some sort, get some of the slipperiness back in there. And it's easy to do with an additive, but it was one of those things that nobody had figured on until they pulled all that sulfur out of there. Another thing that happened to increase were some of the oxidation reactions, because some of these sulfur components worked to stop some of those oxidation reactions that happened earlier with the tinker toy molecules. And once again, additives can help resolve that. All right, so fuel sulfur is one of the big differences of what's going on with the difference in diesel fuels. And it ends up with an effect on the kind of deposits and varnishes and lacquers that can be caused. All right, the next feature, the other feature that's different today than it used to be, is the use of biodiesel, okay, blended biodiesel. Biodiesel, which is, I could put another class together just on that, but biodiesel is a fuel made from the oils of plants. The most common plants are the most common plant oils are canola oil and soy oil. And you take these things, you chemically react them, it goes through this reaction, and you end up with stuff, with a liquid that's very much like diesel fuel. You know, it's the same viscosity, it's the same gravity, or very similar gravity. It's got the same burning characteristics. So very similar. It's got some important differences, of course. And the key thing I want to emphasize that people don't know is how widespread biodiesel is. I mean, people I know have heard of it. People know that you can order special blends of biodiesel, or you can get units that run on 100% biodiesel. You know, you can buy it in varying percentage quantity grades. But 5% biodiesel is everywhere. That's the thing you need to know. The ASTM D975 definition of diesel fuel says you can have up to 5% biodiesel in here and not have to tell anybody about it. You don't have to have it on your pump. Doesn't have to be on a bill of lading. It's just diesel fuel up to that 5%. And of course, it was a happy coincidence that the addition of biodiesel adds back a bunch of lubricity into diesel fuel. So at the 5% level, you don't need any lubricity additives. In fact, at the, I think about somewhere around 1 or 2% of biodiesel gives you all the lubricity that a typical injector does need. So I'm not here trying to tell you that biodiesel is bad or any such thing, but it is what it is. The second thing to note about this stuff, and this we pulled off of a pump, I think over on the, I took a picture of it. It was from a pump at a truck stop on the west side. Contains biomass-based diesel or biodiesel in quantities between 5% and 20%. So you may go up to this pump, if you don't notice the sign, you think you're getting straight diesel fuel, and you could be getting 20% biodiesel, okay, without even knowing it. This is largely driven by the tax structure for fuels. Okay, there are tax subsidies in place, and the people who blend this stuff and put this stuff together are weighing the value of the subsidy versus what their cost is of the biodiesel and sending it out on the market. So this is a definitely an awareness piece, and again, I'm not necessarily bad-mouthing biodiesel, except for standby generators. Okay, that's another story. All right, we've made it through the first third of our presentation here. Does anybody have any questions so far on the material that I covered? Yeah, Doug? Yeah, the question is sulfur a naturally occurring element in the diesel fuel? And the answer to that is yes. Yeah, some crude oils have a lot more sulfur than other crude oils. So as it goes through the refining process, the ones with that started out with more sulfur tend to end up with more sulfur. There are a number of desulfurization steps that go on in a refinery, but that's where it comes from. And of course, now that they're down at 15 parts per million, almost not there at all. This same kind of refining technology also finds its way to lubricants, by the way. That's a different presentation to talk about. But all right, any other questions? Okay, well, we'll go on and talk a little bit about contaminants and what kind of contaminants, at least that we're talking about today. We can categorize these a number of different ways. I'm going to talk about my first division I'm going to use are the internal contaminants to fuel versus the external stuff. Okay, so there are two different broad categories there. The internal contaminants are those that are fuel-based. So we've got two different types of contaminants that can end up in your bulk tank from the fuel itself. And the first is the particulates that I spoke of earlier, right? The ones that start as little bitty reactions going on and reacting and forming very, very tiny components and glomming together and getting bigger and bigger until they finally get to a size where they're heavy enough where they can fall out to the bottom of your tank, okay? Not an uncommon kind of thing. The second kind of internal contaminant are the varnishes, okay? Now, varnish, or sometimes called lacquer, it has been around a very long time. The varnish reactions are some of the ones that remember I mentioned that when there was sulfur in diesel fuel, the sulfur would help keep some of these oxidation reactions from happening. It actually worked as an antioxidant, and it was these varnish type reactions that it was preventing. So we take out the sulfur, suddenly the fuel is more prone to some of this varnish activity. And once again, with the right additives, these things can be held at bay. But a varnish reaction plates out on things, depending on how bad the varnish is. Sometimes it just restricts flow. I mean, a little bit of varnish around a 4-micron injector opening is going to wreak plenty of havoc. And we have seen varnish. I mentioned this probably last year, if you heard this before. We have seen varnish, and it might have even come from the job that this picture came from, that locked up a fuel pump enough that it actually sheared the drive shaft of the fuel pump. Okay? Pretty amazing how that varnish can set. Now, that particular varnish was varnish that not that came from a straight diesel fuel itself, but actually came from biodiesel. But I want to emphasize that varnish can be a real problem, a real internal contaminant. Okay, so those are our two contaminants that can wreak havoc with the system but come from inside the fuel itself, the fuel's degradation byproducts. Okay, now the external contaminants, those coming from the outside, the first one, the most common you think of, is airborne dirt and debris, right? Right? You know, we've all been through a monsoon dust storm. This is the perfect dirt delivery device for our diesel fuel, okay? So there's no question where some of the source is. A lot of that comes in through two, at least from our experience and what we observe when we clean tanks and deal with these kind of problems, comes from two primary sources. One is the main fuel fill opening, okay? We have lots of places that we've gone up to and the fuel opening is just wide open to the air and whatever else comes in, okay? I don't know if you guys had a chance to look at the bag filters Marty has open here outside the garage door, so look at it after the class. He had some bag filters pulling some stuff out of a diesel fuel tank. He's got them out there, he cut them open, all right? You'll have to see it to believe how much dirt and gravel is in there. I mean, it almost looks like someone took a front end loader and dumped it into the tank opening. Some of those rocks in there did not fly in a dust storm. Needless to say that there's lots of ways stuff can get in through an opening left open. The other way, maybe you're very judicious in keeping your fuel fill cap closed or you have a locking system, and that's good, but it's the ventilation system. Okay, Tanks are vented to breathe. You know, they've got to do that. Well, sometimes that breather is nothing but a J-tube with an opening. We see that plenty of times. Sometimes that tube may have a little fitting on there that's got a little bit of screen on there. Okay? All right, well, that keeps birds from getting in there and large insects, but maybe not the small ones, or the dust from that dust storm that came through. So breathers and openings are by far the most common ways that this stuff gets in there. Okay, so after dirt, another common contaminant in fuel tanks is water. Okay, and I wouldn't be surprised if everybody in the room has experienced that at one time or another. I mean, even in, we live in the pretty dry part of the state and of the country, so we don't see this anywhere near as much as people who get highly consistent rainfalls and exist in high humidity environments, but it'll still affect us. All right, so how does water sneak in? Well, the two common ways that we come across is one, we're going to the open lid again, and we have seen that, you know, the tanks with water contamination, but the lid is completely open. The other common method that happens, or common thing that happens, is through condensation, just from humidity in the air. So this is the same process that makes you a good Kentucky whiskey. But what it is your air is loaded with humidity on a given day, and that air finds its way into the open part of your tank, right? And then at nighttime, the air cools down, and all that metal tank gets nice and cool, and all that moisture in the air inside the tank says, hey, there's a nice cool wall to go hang out. And it goes and it leaves the air, its air form turns into droplets on the side of a tank, and they roll their way down to the bottom of the tank. So you start to build up some water. Now, the next day when things heat up, you would hope that it would evaporate, it might evaporate any water, but this water is now very well trapped underneath a layer of diesel fuel, right? So it's not going anywhere. So all this does is ratchet itself to increase. It doesn't, you know, if you've got a tank that hasn't been maintained in a long, long period of time, you can expect this to build up over time, even in a lower humidity environment or like here where we have a little bit of humidity for a few months of the year. Okay, so that's the water as a contaminant. The third contaminant that comes from the outside that we'll see in diesel fuel is bacteria, or algae, or fungus, sometimes all categorized together as biomass, stuff that grows, okay? Well, this stuff is, bacteria exists all around, and it'll grow given the right opportunity. And the bacteria we see in fuel systems lives in the water phase and feeds on the fuel that's right at the water's level, okay? And that's why if you ever look at one of these or a picture of it in a jar, you have two phases, you know, so you get some fuel up here, you got water up here, and you get your black slime as this middle layer. So that's what's going on, it's living in the water, feeding on the fuel. If your tank is kept completely dry, you can have even a high bacteria count in your fuel, but it's not going anywhere and it's not doing anything because it doesn't have the environment, the water environment to live in. All right, so that's the, I think we have some more bacteria pictures later on. We'll be talking a little bit more about that as a problem as well. So those are the contaminants that we see. We got the internal contaminants, external contaminants, and for our diesel fuel. Okay, now we're gonna talk a little bit more about the cleanliness and what does clean fuel actually mean. So we're gonna go and consider the question that's been pondered for, minutes. That is, how clean is clean, okay? How do we know what is clean? So we gotta start by getting some background and talk about the particle size. All right, we've already talked about these micron size stuff, and I'm gonna go review that. I kinda got ahead of in talking about how small microns were. All right, so your first takeaway thing, if anything from this presentation, a micron is very, very, very small, all right? The human hair, a human hair shaft is about 70 microns in diameter. So compared to a micron, that's pretty good size. The human visibility limit is only down to 40 microns, okay? Somewhere in that range. That's the smallest the eye can detect. Typical motor oil filter is in this 50 to 70 range. Of the kind of stuff that you can pull out of a motor oil filter. Some relative particle sizes, grain of table salt, maybe 100 microns, okay? A particle of talc powder, 10 microns. So you don't see those individual particles without a microscope. And our bacteria is down around this 2 to 3 micron range, okay? So what you should have in mind here is that the openings in a diesel, in a high-pressure diesel system, some of those critical clearances and openings are big enough for a bacteria to exist. We're talking about filtering things to, to filter, to get all of that out here, you'd be filtering to a sterile level, you know, a surgically sterile level, which is, it's pretty remarkable how, again, how tiny these openings are. Okay, so particle size plays a role in deciding how dirty things are, how and how we're gonna clean them up, the ways to clean them up. Particle shape, same thing as well, okay? A typical, when you talk about particle shapes and the people who do mathematical models of filters, everybody always assumes a particle is a hard sphere, hard spherical particle. And so everybody kind of thinks of that when they think, oh, okay, we got a particle we're gonna have to filter out. But the fact is that in reality, when you take it, when you hit the real world, that assumption falls away pretty quick. So particles can also be very cylindrical in their nature. Okay, not as easy to filter out. Particles can also be spongy or globby, a particle that can change shape or move a little bit in the right situation. All right, so this all affects what you can clean and how you have to clean it. All right, so at always the risk of doing something on live TV, we're going to go to the demo now. So I'm going to pull over my handy-dandy demo tail. Okay. So we're all living in Candyland, where our diesel engines are all powered by Skittles. All right, so let's get some diesel going here. And this is our supply of fuel operated by Skittles, and the Skittles work fine. And then one day, one of those mean guys in Candyland says, aha, we're gonna put some atomic fireballs in your diesel tank. Okay, so now our diesel fuel is grossly contaminated with these cinnamon fireballs. What are we gonna do? Well, we're gonna pull out our handy filter system. Okay, this is our filter system, and for anybody, and I know you're wondering this question, how many microns is this filter? Well, only me would have gone through the effort of calculating it. This is a 12,000 micron filter. Anyway, so we take our contaminated diesel fuel and we're going to filter it. And you can see we've managed to clear up and get out all our atomic fireballs from our diesel fuel. Okay, that's good. But things would have been different if our arch enemy had chosen hot tamales, right? Again, hot tamales are not a hard cylinder like all these guys were. Excuse me, not a hard sphere. Hot tamales are more of a cylinder. So a hot tamale can seem like it might be getting filtered, or it might be able to be held up by the filter, but it doesn't take much for it to be thwarted. All it takes is the proper alignment, right? So that's one of the reasons that shape is important. Now, the third type of element that we were talking about before was those that are globby or spongy or change shape. So if our arch enemy had chosen mini marshmallows as a contaminant, you can see what's happening to that filter. We got a couple of them that are small enough to get through. And keep in mind, there's going to be some pressure on this stuff as there's stuff flowing through there, right? And so the problem with any of them that change shape real easy is it doesn't take much in the way of pressure to overcome the filter if these guys can change shape. So that's why there's not one filter for filtering all types of contaminants. You really have to be very thoughtful in designing your filter and design something a little more robust than my Dunlop filter here. Okay, we've talked just a little bit about the filter and get you guys on this contaminant shape thing. So you realize that not all contaminants are the same in terms of their shape and their texture and how hard they are. I also want to talk about measuring cleanliness, because there are a number of ways to do it, and there's plenty of confusion with measuring cleanliness. So we'll take a look at some of the at four of the common methods for measuring cleanliness of a diesel fuel. And the first is going to be something that should be obvious. It's visual. This is one of our sample tubes. We go down. We put, I think we have a little video clip of it later too. You put this down into a tank. It pulls a sample from the bottom. You pull it up, and you can get a visual on it right away. And you can also put it into a sample bottle and take it to a lab if you'd like. This is one over here as well. This is a clear tube, by the way. What do you think of the diesel fuel from that tank? Okay, that's a clear tube. You can see it's clear over there, and you can see there's some water in the bottom of red diesel there. This sample here. Do these samples need to be taken to a lab to find out if this fuel needs to be cleaned? Okay, it's a visual test. It's pretty cheap. It's obviously it's the first thing you do. Okay. The second, another common test, and one that you should be aware of, and you may be aware of, is the centrifuge test, usually referred to as BS&W, which is short for bottom sediment and water, or sometimes basic sediment and water. You put a sample in there, and your sample can look fairly clear or might be slightly cloudy. You put it in here, this thing spins around at a centrifuge at some 10,000 RPM, and you end up with liquid in here, where the fuel is up here and your heavier stuff, so your particles and your water, end up down here, and you read it off the scale as to how much you have. And the end of the lab will report that as a percentage. This test and this test specification have been around diesel fuel for as long as there's been diesel fuel. So it's a very fundamental test. Lots of labs run it. It's not terribly expensive. But it does not do a good job of telling you how much is water and how much is sediment. So how much of it's dirt, how much is water. But it'll tell you that there's bad stuff in there. Another test that we use and can be used is a filter patch test. This is a test that can be done on site. You can see it comes in a kit. You're basically running a sample, sucking it through a filter patch. And you take your filter patch, you look at it under a little field microscope, and you compare it to some standards and say, this has got a lot of particles in it compared to what it should have. So you get immediate, right away, understanding of whether you've got too much dirt in there or whether it's really pretty clean. And then there are the laboratory particle count methods. Okay, talk a little bit here about particle counts. Particle counts are these machines, like you see here, that'll pull up a sample and measure the actual number of particles in a given sample of the product. Now, there are three broad categories of particle counters out there. Lots of different brands, but three broad categories. The first is called a pore blockage particle counter, where it actually has, it's measuring how many of the pores. It's like a little filter thing, and it measures how much blockage actually occurs I'm going to grab this number out of the hat, say, of a 10 micron filter. And it'll tell you, okay, you've got, since that sample covered 90% of the holes in here, that are 10 micron holes, it must have so many particles that are 10 microns or larger. This is not real commonly used, but it is still used by plenty of labs. The optical particle counter is probably the most commonly one used. This is a pretty intuitive idea that you've got a sample going through. And I will say something about these samples. The samples that these are measured on are usually, not more than a few drops, okay? Way less than an ounce. Let's see, maybe a teaspoonful of stuff gets sampled. And taking a good sample from your tank is important, right? You have less than a teaspoon, maybe a half teaspoonful of sample is speaking for the entire 10,000 gallon tank of diesel fuel. Okay? So grabbing a good sample and a hopefully representative sample is very important. And this optical particle counter takes this stuff, shines a light through it, and there's a photocell on the other end. So if a particle comes through this very, it goes through a very tiny tube, and it casts a little shadow, the little photo counter over there says, oh, there's a shadow, that's one particle. And they, so you know you put so many milliliters of fluid through, and you got so many shadows, so you must have so many particles per, and that's how it goes up and tells you, you have 10,000 particles in your sample, or some such thing. That's the optical system. And the optical system had been with us a long time, and it worked really well. But it's got its, well, I say worked really well enough, has its own set of flaws. And then the laser net finds method was developed. Okay, the laser net finds is kind of the gold standard, at least these days. The laser net finds method, well, I've got a slide on it, I'll show you in a second what makes it. It's kind of like an optical counter, but a lot smarter. Okay. Here's the takeaway. Here's something to take away. These particle counts methods, nobody agrees with each other. I saw a very good test that Chevron had done doing particle counts on oils where they took an identical sample, very carefully prepared identical sample, ran it on two different particle counters in their labs, sent it out. I think there were a total of either 14 or 16 total samples runs. We sent it out to 7 or 8 labs, 2 of them, had everybody run it, didn't tell them they were the same sample or anything like that, got results all over the map. And these were well-respected labs, too, all over the map. Some were a lot worse than others. And a lot of them using identical equipment still had a lot of variance. So, you know, working with somebody who knows how to run these machines and maybe sometimes getting additional duplicate runs done can be important, but again, the results can vary all over the place. Okay, this is how that laser net finds work. This is not on the exam, so you don't have to build one of these from a kit. But you've got your product is flowing through here. You got a laser going through here, as opposed to just a high beam light, and you're going on to a photocell. But in this case, this and the computer it's hooked up to are analyzing the shape of the particle. And they're analyzing the shape of the particle even as it moves, even if this is moving and that is moving. So, for instance, it is smart enough to determine whether the particle it sees is a glob of water or a hard particle. This is something the optical particle counters can't do. They can't tell us water from a solid particle contaminant. But these guys can. And they can also count and track the shape of the type of particles in there, which doesn't make as big a difference in the fuel world. But in the oil world, you can tell perhaps where the wear is coming from by the shape of the particle showing up in your particle count. Okay. Like I said, that's not on the exam. You're going to be okay. But these particle counters all come up with these numbers, like, okay, we came up with this many particles at this level, at 4 microns, and this many particles at 6 microns, you know, 10,862 particles at 6 microns, and 985 particles at 16 microns. It's a bunch of confusing stuff that comes out of these particle counts. So there are a number of systems on how to report a particle count. Okay, there are at least 3 or 4 of them that I'm familiar with, but one of them is vastly more widely used than the other. And that is the ISO cleanliness scale. Okay, and the ISO cleanliness scale is it's the most common, and it's reported with these 3 values that you see. It'll be 3 different values, like this 18, 16, 13. Okay? Sometimes with some oils, like gear oils is the classic example, they only use the last 2 of them. You don't report the first 2, but that's kind of an esoteric thing. Keep in mind that what these guys are measuring are particles that you can't see. Okay, this is still well below the vision limit. The numbers come from measuring particles at 4 microns, 6 microns, and 16 microns. So particles down there can be well below what you see. I can't say how the system came about. But I do know that it does give you some idea, not just how much dirt is in your system, but kind of a profile of how dirty it is. Sometimes if the first number is really high and the next two are low, that'll tell you something about your system or maybe even the filters you have in your system. Okay. Another important takeaway is that smaller numbers are the cleaner numbers. Okay. And so better when you have a set of them like that, that's better to be 18, 16, 14. If you ever have a number where any of these numbers are higher than the number before it, something's wrong. The way the math works on this, that can't happen. So something got goofed up somewhere along the way, if that's the case. And in fact, only when you get down into really low numbers, like 12, 8, and 6 is down in those guys, are you ever likely to see two of them the same. It is mathematically possible to have two of them the same. So I've seen things that were like 12, 6, 6. Things like that. And when they're really clean stuff, you can't have two of them identical. Okay? Here's the bottom line. You probably lose your mind if you really spend much time. It cost me my mind when I first came upon this and trying to figure this stuff out. My belief is that the people who put together this system did this while working for a big company and then left the company to form a consultancy where they could make outrageous consulting fees explaining this to people. I really think that's what they did. Okay, but that's now when you see these three numbers together, you at least know that that's the particle count. Smaller is better. Okay, we'll move on to some of the fundamentals of filtration. What we've done, the first kind of filter, the really basic filter we talk about is a screen, like my Dunlop filter over here, right? It is a screen. You could measure your micron distance in between there and figure out what you're holding up. This is a very intuitive kind of filter, but it's also very inefficient because what happens once we start to get this loaded up with atomic fireballs, right? Pretty soon we've loaded up the capacity of this filter. Not much can get through. So if we'd had a whole layer of atomic fireballs on there and then put more Skittles on there, it's completely plugged, right? We're not getting any filtering done. So that's one of the limitations of a screen type of filter. The next and probably the most commonly used type of filter, and one of that gets a job and gets around that capacity problem, are depth filters or depth media, where there are many, many tortuous paths through the filter that the liquid can take and places where whatever our contaminant is can get stopped up and get trapped and collected. The sand filter on your swimming pool is a pretty good example of a depth type filter, where you get some particle in there, well, the water's finding another way to get through, and you still get filtration going on because it's a big honking thick filter bed. Okay, so depth media is a real common, really efficient way to go. And then the third type of filter is adsorbent media. Okay, now adsorbent media is for those things, an example is like if our arch enemy had tried to gum up the works by pouring in honey into the diesel fuel, would our filter have done us any good at pulling out the honey? No, because it's maybe this thick viscous liquid, but it's not going to be stopped up by the filter. Well, our absorbent media works kind of like this. Your contaminant is dissolved in your diesel fuel floating along, and as it goes through the absorbent media, the contaminants in there saying, hey, that absorbent media is having a party. This is kind of boring here. I'm going to go hang out at this party. So it leaves the diesel fuel, goes over and hangs on, actually grabs onto or bonds with the absorbent media. Okay? And that's how the contaminants end up being cleaned from the fuel. Think of it as they're electively leaving the fuel to go onto the absorbent media. And an example of where this happens at home is if you have a carbon filter on your water system. Okay, your carbon filter is there to grab bad smelling stuff, those aromatics that are dissolved in your water, And as it goes through activated carbon, there are preferential adsorption onto the carbon surface, so they leave the water, so you get better tasting water. All right, so that's adsorbent media. There's plenty of other filtration media and filtration stuff we could talk about, but won't, because they don't doesn't really apply much to diesel fuel. That includes the air, the types of air filters there are, and impingement air filters, or oil-water separators is another kind of separation and filtration mechanism, so we're not going to spend any time with those. But we're going to are going to move on to talk a little bit about the micron ratings of filters. Okay, we now all know how small microns are, and filters are frequently sold with specifications that include micron ratings. So here's some need to know stuff, or hopefully helpful to know stuff, about micron ratings and filters. First of all, you may see some ratings that are referred to as absolute ratings, and you may see some that are nominal ratings. Okay, someone said this is a 25 micron nominal filter, or nominal 25 micron filter. Okay, when you see this is a nominal 25 micron filter, what you need to think is this is anywhere from 15 to 200 microns plus or minus. Okay, the term nominal, when it's used on a filtration, means, and this is my wise guy coming through, it means we're too lazy to have this thing officially tested, or we can't manufacture them consistently enough to meet the same specs, so we're going to give it a nominal classification. That means ballpark is really what it means, and it is. On the other hand, absolute filtration means they went through a test protocol with some official ASTM dust, and yes, there is such a stuff, to do the measurement on this and get an actual rating on it. Okay, so a 25 micron absolute filter is going to do a pretty good job at filtering everything to 25 microns. Okay, that's the absolute versus nominal. But also keep in mind that even absolute isn't really absolute. Okay, stuff does get through these filters. So your 25 micron absolute filter, even from the best filter supplier out there, is going to allow an occasional 28, 30 micron particle downstream. I mean, that can happen. So, and that's demonstrated or exhibited or displayed or explained by the efficiency of the filter, and which is sometimes called its beta ratio. So some are better than others is the bottom line there. And how you know that is hopefully you're buying from a good enough supplier who reports the beta ratio on these things. The beta ratio is nothing more than having your test filter in line here. And if you put 200 particles at it and one of it makes it through, there's your ratio, 200 to 1. So that's a beta of 200. So that would be a 25 micron beta 200 filter. If you can put 2,000 particles in here and only one escapes, well, now your beta ratio is 2,000. Okay, 2,000 beta ratio is a pretty good number. That's a pretty good number to have on your filter. So that'd be pretty well respected. So keep in mind that your beta ratio and your efficiency is going to vary, because you can probably count that 200 beta filter is going to cost you less than the 2,000 beta filter. Okay, we're now going to talk about testing fuel cleanliness. This is a little bit redundant with some of the testing and measuring we were talking about before. There are lots and lots of fuel tests of various sorts to run on fuel. There are a subset of that for cleanliness, and we're going to talk about four specific ones of those. We're testing for four different items. We got tests here for dirt, for water. How do we test for bacteria in our diesel fuel? And what kind of tests can we run for varnish? All right, so let's take a look at that. Let's see, we have our spokes model Sean here pulling a sample and using one of those clear tubes. That's how we pull a good bottom sample. This one didn't have a bunch of goop in the bottom, but we can pull a sample and get a very good one to send off to the lab there. Okay. And, watch this video stream. This is Marty back here is taking, he's got a stinger, a suction tube, and he's putting it down into a tank of fuel. And you can watch how the fuel changes as that pickup tube goes deeper and deeper into this fuel tank. Looking pretty good there. He's getting deeper. Uh-oh, he's getting down bottom. Ooh, there's the good stuff right there. All right, so one of the things that we can do for testing, as we did before, is get a visual test on it, okay? We also talked about doing BS and W, and I explained what that was, the bottom sediments and water. You can do a particle count, okay? Particle count is, again, if you can have a pretty clean visual and a pretty clean BS and W, but if you really want the clean feel you need, you're starting to talk about getting particle counts. And I say that because there's an overriding question here. Well, how clean should my fuel be? Right? We know we don't want that. But if that was clear all the way down there, we say, well, is it clean enough? And how do we know what level it should be clean to if we do a particle count on it? Okay, well, the OEMs of engines do have cleanliness recommendations. You guys, some of you may know of this, some of you may not. We do find a number of people that are surprised that there are actual OEM recommendations on the cleanliness. It turns out that they're in much agreement. Caterpillar is a big proponent of fluid cleanliness, if anybody deals with Cat. That's a huge thing for them. They've been, for a long time, had this 18-16-13 spec. Cummins has the same fuel cleanliness requirement. And the Worldwide Fuel Charter. You may not have heard of the Worldwide Fuel Charter, but it's an organization made up of other organizations, these guys, which is the Japanese auto manufacturers, the European auto manufacturers, the truck manufacturers, and the American auto manufacturers. They go into all these groups, came together, put together the Worldwide Fuel Charter, and again, the same cleanliness specifications. So this is unlike many other standards that are out there. This is pretty commonly agreed on, at least by the engine OEMs. In digging out some of this information, I thought it was kind of interesting that the diesel injector manufacturers are kind of like standing in the back of the room going, oh, call on me, because they want numbers that are like 12.63 or something like that. They want it really, really tight. And again, for people who are making stuff that have 1 to 4 micron openings in it, you would expect them to want as clean a fuel as possible. All right, testing for fuel cleanliness. We talked a little bit we had before with the dirt, so now we have water as a contaminant. How are we going to test for water? Anybody here familiar with water paste? We use water paste a lot. Anytime we make a diesel fuel delivery, the drivers put paste on the end of the stick. You put it down in the tank. You pull it up and see if there's known water in the bottom of that tank. It'll turn this paste color. The problem is that this test is often enough fooled. So you can't rely on it all the time. Something on a layer of something that it's going through that is sitting down between the water and the fuel can coat the paste and give it a coating, and then the water will never see it, for instance. That's one way. That same BS and W test, again, that can give you some idea if you've got water in your system. The bottom sample for a visual, going up for a tube or a thief, that's another easily run test. All right, and I think, there's an example of some water showing up in those. Let's see, we're gonna watch, I think we're watching Sean take the same sample he did before. Can't remember if that's from a different angle or not. But at least you guys will know that we have these, most of our reps have these cool tube things with them. By the way, if any of our reps are coming by and you need a fuel sample, you can ask them, they can assemble them together and go grab a fuel sample. Okay, so we covered particles, we covered water, testing fuel for algae, bacteria, biomass. All right, these are some examples of stuff that can come out of algae. This is not in the tank. This is what happens once the tank pickup has it and it's made it into a fuel tank and found its way to a filter of some sort, one of the filters in line. This dead live or dead, the algae will do this. So if you have algae in your tank and you give some biocide and you kill it, you can still pump it out and have this happen. Yeah, so killing, if you've got algae and you need to treat it, you treat it to kill it, and then you still have to clean out the dead bodies. Okay? You'll know you have fungus by visual testing. That's almost always the case. Significant. The stuff smells, so you can get the smell. That'll confirm that, yeah, this is biomass. And you can use dip slides. You can use dip slides in your diesel fuel to determine if it's got a high bio load. It may not have any water where it's growing yet. You know, it may not be in that situation, but you can tell if there's an enormous amount of bacteria and bacterial potential. And these dip slides are pretty simple to use. They're something on a paddle. You take it, you dip it in for 2 seconds, you pull it out, put it back in its tube, you let it incubate for 24 hours, maybe 48, and it grows little spots on this panel. Like you see the spots there, and you go to a little chart and says, oh, it's got about that many spots, it's got heavy growth. Okay, so that's our that's the bugs in there. All right, so the fourth kind of contaminant that we're testing for or doing some tests about is the varnish. Okay, again, the most critical situation where we're testing for varnish is in a standby generator set, because the standby generator set does not process much fuel. That fuel can be in there for years, and that's when these varnish reactions have their best opportunity to go to town. If the tank's being turned quite a bit, there's much less, not a zero risk, but much less of a risk. That's why the OEMs of gen sets either say don't use biodiesel at all or only use it if you're going to be going through that tank in 6 months or less. Okay, we have three tests that we run on product looking for varnish-related tests. There's no way to measure exactly varnish, but you're kind of measuring possible varnish or what could happen. The MPC test is a test that measures the varnish potential. The P actually stands for patch, because what you do is you run a sample through this patch. You end up with a discoloration. That discoloration could be either from very light to very dark. And instead of eyeballing it and saying, oh, that looks like it's about a 50% chance of creating some varnish or something like that, there's an actual device that measures a standard darkness of it and gives the actual MPC value number. Okay, so good MPC value numbers are, you know, 15 and lower than that. Goes up when you see things that are 60 and higher, they're almost black. And that means varnish is happening while you watch it. That's a pretty well far gone fuel. The second test we may run, depending again on the need for a fuel that, again, somebody might be expecting to store for a long time, is called petro-oxy. Petro-oxy is an oxidation test that forces a very small sample and says, okay, you know, in the next hour, I'm gonna treat you like you're aging for a year. Okay, so it force conditions it, determines how much it oxidizes, gives you some idea if it's gonna be a long-lived fuel or not. And the third test that we often run, particularly for people with gen sets, can for others, is called FAME. FAME is an acronym for fatty acid methyl ester, which is the geek term for biodiesel. So this is a biodiesel test. Do you have biodiesel in there? And again, the genset may want none at all, so this is, we're not as likely to run this unless the customer really wants it on a tank for a fleet that keeps turning that tank pretty regular. Okay, any questions so far? We've reached the second half. Yes, sir.
What are the good numbers for petrol oxy, good number and bad number?
Okay, the question is, what's a good number and what's a bad number for a petrol oxy? All right, the petrol oxy test, this force test, is to make it simple, they just measure how many minutes it takes for it to fail this test. And generally the threshold number is around 70 minutes as a new fuel, okay? So anything 70 or higher is pretty good. If it's below 70, you do a retest. This is not a super, that 70 retest might give you 78, it might give you 62 if you were to retest it. But when you're below 50, then you gotta pay really close attention. And we see plenty of them that go 10 minutes and stuff like that. Yes, sir? Make sure I understand, because the question is, okay, if you've got sediment, your sediment's heavy enough, it falls to the bottom of your tank, right? And it's below the level of your pickup tube, right, okay? Right, the pickup tube is not at the bottom. To pick up tube, but I'm going to give you guys a quick lesson in pickup tube dynamics. I mean, in theory, you could develop finely enough sediment to make its way up there. All right, and that's a lot of sediment, especially when you think about the cylindrical nature. As you go higher, you've got more volume to cover. That's, don't take me to the math. I'm going to have PTSD from math class. But water in a tank is an additional problem with that. You can have water that resides down there and has resided there for a really long time, and with no bacteria, it's okay. And as water builds up, eventually you're going to get close to it. And there's a classic scenario where you're finally close enough to the pickup tube where at this end of the tank, they're dropping a load of fuel in, okay? And that fuel is sloshing things around, and this whole interface surface gets going like this, right? And finally, it is making its way up to the pickup tube because it's been disturbed by dropping fuel at the far end of the tank. So, and there's not necessarily an industry standard of how far a pickup tube has to be off the bottom of the tank. So that's not a measurement one can always rely on. Any other questions? All right, we'll get on to the third half of the show here. And that is, we've got dirty fuel in a dirty tank. What are we going to do about it? Okay, so first of all, if what you've got is dirt and particles, and that's really all you got, what you do, which is kind of the classic scenario, right? This has been a problem going back decades and decades. So what do you do about it? You do fuel polishing. This is the terminology that's most commonly used. What it is is just a filter. So it's kind of the traditional method. And you're hooking up a filter, you run it through, it comes out a certain cleanliness, you get it to the cleanliness level you need, get it back in your system, or maybe you recirculated it the whole time, you end up with a nice clean tank of fuel, and that's really all you need to do is the polishing. And this is what a lot of companies do. Many people will knock on your door and say, oh yeah, we are your fuel treater. They're not doing much more than polishing. They may also treat with an additive afterwards. But some of these other things that are done are either things that are extra features, or maybe a lot of these companies don't do, like dealing with water, dealing with bacteria, or dealing with varnish. But if all you got is the dirt and particles, polishing is what you need to get her done. Okay? All right, dealing with water. Okay, this is a little more situational. How bad is the water? How long has it been there? Has it had any effect? How often do you turn out your tank? Because you can pump everything out of your tank, okay, just get that tank completely empty, let the water split from the fuel and pump back just the fuel part. Or some similar system to that. Maybe you pump out that tank from the bottom, so you get the water out of the bottom of it until you're pulling fuel out. You let that split, return any fuel you want. So you can do a basic split. It can be done. That doesn't get out any dissolved water, or if you've got any kind of visible haze, then you've got plenty of water in your system. You need to do something further. And that is to go after it with an absorption type system, okay, for taking the water out of diesel fuel. So you run it through a filter system that's designed to remove water. The water preferentially leaves the diesel fuel, preferred for the adsorption filter, comes back dry. Okay, it is actually, in the big picture of things, that's a pretty straightforward operation. You know, the operator is going to monitor and determine when that adsorption filter is loaded up, pops it off, puts a new one in, keep going. Okay. And for varnish, something a little bit different. For varnish, you need another kind of specialty kind of adsorbent to pull the varnish. I'm saying varnish, but it's varnish precursors. It's those molecules that have been damaged and are on the edge of becoming some sort of varnish in there. So you need to circulate it through special system, special adsorption filter, pull that stuff out of there. And we do this pretty successfully in many cases. Change that MPC test that we saw with the patches, change the petrooxy test with some additive. Okay, so we've got our fuel all cleaned up. Does it make sense to put our clean fuel back into a dirty tank? Not usually. So if what you had is just dirt and a sludge in the bottom, a diesel power wash can do it. We have a couple different washing systems that we use for getting in there, blasting stuff out, recycling it out. You know, you filter it out. It's using the diesel fuel as a cleaning agent, because you're really relying on the force to clean stuff out, so we can get tanks cleaned that way. It's pretty straight, cleaning dirtiness like that's a pretty straightforward job. If you've got biomass in your tank, if you've got some algae that had been built up, well, that can be a little bit different. It all depends on where in the tank it is, how long it might have been there. Sometimes you can do it with the same kind of power wash you can with dirt. Sometimes you have to go at with an aggressive cleaner to get the stuff off. Okay. Varnish is an even tougher customer. With varnish, you need to go at it with some aggressive chemistry, some special solvent. Maybe you circulate diesel fuel with some additional additives in there, and those additives work as a cleaner inside to go after. But you're circulating the whole thing, knowing you're likely to end up discarding that. The fuel that you put that additive in. Cleaning up varnish is a bit more of a challenge, but it's the same kind of thing. You circulate. You don't blast varnish off with high pressure spray. You got to go at it chemically. All right. So if we already cleaned up our fuel and we cleaned up our tank, we really don't want to go through this again, right? So let's talk about prevention. Okay. The first thing everybody should do is consider sealing the openings, making sure the fill location, any of that stuff, has not just a kind of a general cap over it, yet something with a good seal on it. And next is the breathers. The tank does have to breathe, but it doesn't have to breathe dirty air. So breather, you would like it to be filtered. Get this down there. Get a 5 micron or less breather filter on there. Okay? Keep the diesel fuel clean. And use a desiccant type filter. That's what that high pro is over there. Okay? That's gonna absorb any water that's in the air as that tank breathes. So the inside of your tank doesn't end up with a high humidity environment that can then condense on the walls and end up in the bottom of your tank. Okay? Absorbent breathers, very helpful. You can also make sure you've got the appropriate size tank if you've got the flexibility to do this. This is one of these things that, you know, if you've got a 10,000-gallon underground tank, you can't say, you know, our business has gone down a little bit. We better dig that up and put in a 6,000-gallon tank. You know, that doesn't make sense. But when you've got a chance to size a tank right, That it goes a long way towards preventing problems, just like the condensate problem. Okay. And next, buy from a reputable supplier. Now this is a technical presentation. We don't make a sales pitch, so we randomly chose a unidentifiable supplier picture to show a reputable supplier. But a reputable supplier can go a long way in making and helping be sure that your product is uncontaminated when delivered. Okay, our company's been around a long time. We've hired a lot of people from other companies and have heard many interesting stories about shortcuts that were taken. Our distribution department doesn't like shortcuts at all. Nobody does shortcuts there, and you can pick out the occasional frustration from some of our salespeople here that happens. But we're dedicated to delivering quality product around here. Two, set up regular testing of your fuel. Doesn't have to be high dollar testing, and it doesn't have to be every 2 weeks. I mean, we're talking 6 months, you know, maybe a year, depending on what you're testing for, that kind of stuff. Just make sure it gets done. Have it tested kind of regularly, kind of keep an eye on things. And use additives when they might be necessary. If you've got a stationary generator set, you should be putting in an oxidation stability additive, something to help it live longer, avoid oxidation, avoid the varnish and the dropout that can happen. All right? So oxidation additives are, especially on a per gallon basis, pretty cheap insurance. And biocides. If you're in an environment where you've had to battle bugs before, infections, you end up with water that you can't keep out. Maybe you're next to an environment that a lot of bacteria seems to end up in your tank. Okay, you can treat this stuff with low-level biocide on a regular basis and keep that kind of stuff at bay, preventative problem. All right. All right, this is it. Any other questions on the third little short segment here? Yes, sir. The question is when purchasing a fuel from us, can we get the additives put in advance as opposed to putting it in? The short answer to that is yes. We do that for any number of customers. And you need to talk to the representative, of course, to establish which additives you might want, but that becomes then part of the profile when we make a delivery. All right, any other questions? Very good. I want to thank everybody for your attention today.
Thank you. Awesome. Russ, thanks once again. Well done. Just in closing here, I do have three people. So many of you wanted a certificate. It is on the kind of desk out front. As you walk out, you can grab your certificate. And I have three, Ernesto, Reed, and Dale. I'll print yours here in just a few minutes if you'll just hang out for just a few minutes. We're going to send a survey after this. We'd love your feedback. How was the training? How was the food? How was the timing? The environment? So look for just a brief email, and we appreciate your attention. Feel free to check out the Clean Fluids trailer here to get a feel for how we handle clean fluids. We are certainly leading the valley and the kind of this side of the U.S. in terms of keeping fluids clean, both on the fuel and lubricant side. And so you can check out our expertise there. Thanks for your attendance. Have a great day. We'll talk to you later. Bye.